This video is protein synthesis, part one of two. We'll break it into two parts because there's really two major processes in protein synthesis. Part one is called transcription, and so that's what we're going to talk about today. So in one of my previous videos called The Genetic Code, click the link, go and check it out if you haven't already, we talked about the link between DNA and proteins. How there's these genes on chromosomes that are sections of chromosomes made of DNA, of course, that hold the code or instructions telling a cell how to make proteins. We even learnt how the language of DNA works with our A's, T's, C's and G's and those three-letter combinations called codons. What we haven't talked about is how do we get that gene, that instruction telling the cell how to make a protein and actually go through the manufacturing process to produce a protein? Well, that's what we're going to look at in this video. First of all, we need to understand the flow of information in cells is from DNA to RNA to protein. And we're going to focus on that first part, going from DNA information to RNA information in a process called transcription. The first thing you might be wondering is why two steps? Why not simply take our DNA information and just produce a protein? Well, to answer that question, I'm going to bring in a very special prop that I'm quite excited about. Guys, introducing my wife's banana cake. Delicious. Sorry about that. Couldn't help myself. Neither can many people at all. My wife's banana cake is unbelievable. And she makes it from a recipe in a very special family cookbook that has been passed down from generation to generation. All of my wife's friends want the recipe to this banana cake, and she's more than happy to give it to them. But what she doesn't want to do is give her friends her very special family recipe book. There's just a risk that it could go missing, it could get damaged, it's far too precious for that. So what is a solution? Well, I'm sure you're thinking out there, make a photocopy. And that's exactly what she does. She photocopies the banana cake recipe and then she can give it to as many friends as she likes. The benefits of that are she keeps her own family copy very safe. It's not going to be damaged and there's no risk. She can make several copies, give them to several friends, and they can produce several cakes in their own kitchens, in their own homes. So guys, I have not lost the plot. I promise you I'm linking this back to today's video. Remember that the flow of information is DNA to RNA to protein, and I'm trying to explain to you why this RNA step is so important. And the reason is, as we know, the DNA is stored in the nucleus of the cell. But what you might not know is that proteins are actually made at the ribosomes in the cytoplasm of the cell. Now, the DNA is far too precious and far too important to be traveling all the way out to the cytoplasm where proteins are made. Just like my wife's cookbook is far too precious to be giving out to people to take home and who knows what's going to happen to it. So instead, what we do is we make a copy of that DNA message. That copy, if you haven't already guessed it, is called messenger RNA. The advantage of that is we look after our DNA, it stays in the nucleus, but the other advantage, we can make several copies, therefore we can make several proteins. Just like my wife giving out several recipes to make several cakes. So let's have a look at how we actually get our RNA message produced from the DNA sequence. So I've got a diagram here of a double helix where part of the double helix has unwound and the strands have separated. Now, I'm going to give you a warning here. Be careful. Lots of students get this process, transcription, confused with DNA replication. The difference is in DNA replication, the entire double helix unzips and the entire double helix is replicated and we end up with two DNA molecules at the end of the process. In transcription, all that's happening is the DNA is unzipping just at the area where the gene is located. And then at the end of the process, once we've made our messenger RNA, the DNA double helix is going to close back up again and nothing will have happened to the original DNA molecule. So that's the difference between this transcription process and DNA replication. So the thing that's missing in this diagram are the free nucleotides that we know exist inside the nucleus. So I'm just going to place in our DNA, I'm just going to place in our nucleotides. They're actually not DNA nucleotides, which is why I've coloured them red. They're actually RNA nucleotides because we're going to be forming RNA, messenger RNA. So one of the strands acts as a template strand, and it's going to act as a template for the production of this RNA molecule. So complementary base pairing is what's going to occur. So where we have a T, we're going to need an A. But where we have an A, we're not going to find a T in RNA. In RNA, instead of T, we have U. So here we go, the A will pair up with a U, the C will need to pair up with a G, this other C will pair up with a G, and so on and so forth. Another C, another G. The G is going to need a C, this A is going to pair up with a U, T will pair up with A, C and G, and our final T will pair up with an A. That process will keep occurring along the length of the gene. Now let's just remind ourselves, genes are up to hundreds of base pairs long. So this is definitely not a gene, it's just for the simplicity of the diagram, I've kept it short. So the DNA will keep unzipping until we reach the end of the gene and the mRNA will keep forming. That process that we saw of the mRNA forming is aided by an enzyme called RNA polymerase. Now, at the end of the process, we will have produced an RNA molecule, like this one. Oh, not bad, hey? Right, now, this RNA molecule, this is our copy now. We can take this copy, it will move out of the nucleus through the nuclear pore, which are like little holes in the nuclear membrane, and out to the ribosome in the cytoplasm, where protein synthesis will occur. The double strands will rejoin, this DNA will remain unchanged, and we've got our copy. So here's just another diagram of the same process of transcription that I just showed you. It's probably a little bit harder to understand, but you've got the DNA strands which are separating at the location of the gene. The RNA nucleotides are coming in and base pairing in a complementary manner to produce a messenger RNA molecule, which then moves out of the nucleus, the DNA strands rejoin, and that's our process of transcription. This is a final diagram to help you understand transcription. This is the nuclear membrane here. So you've got to imagine the nucleus is here, and the actual cell membrane would be way out here. So we're zoomed right in on our cell here. And there's a couple of genes here. The DNA is separating at the location of the gene, messenger RNA is forming, it then moves out of the nuclear pore, which is that little hole in the nuclear membrane, out into the cytoplasm to the ribosome, where the message that has been transcribed can now be translated into a protein. Translation is going to be part two of this protein synthesis video series. I hope you're looking forward to it as much as I am. I'm going to take off, go and have some more of my wife's banana cake. Thanks very much for watching, and we'll see you next time.